then you become more perfect. And I think that if there is one big risk, is that especially these large organizations don't dare to change. And I think that if there is no change, then I'm out. I love change. I love to do things different. And so when the entire market is looking at outsourcing, I look at insourcing. And when everyone is trying to standardize its mainframe, I try to get rid of the mainframe. And in a sense, I think it's all about change. And change with, and not triggered by me, but at least inspired a bit. And I hope that the entire engineering workforce will feel the freedom to actually make that change happen. I think that is fundamental to the journey that we have in ING. So what have we been doing? I think if you look at a company like ING, you have to become a bit careful that you forget what your purpose is. And yeah, you could say Scala is very cool, but why do we need Scala? You could say mainframe is very cool, but why do we need a mainframe? Or it's not cool, but then what problems are we going to overcome if we get rid of the mainframe? And these kind of decisions you can only do if you look at the corporate strategy. And what I used to think is that many IT organizations within large corporates, they basically have this vision, we will enable the business. But if your slogan is we will enable a business, it basically means someone else has a great idea and you make that happen. I think fundamentally that course is shifting towards IT is driving the business. We are driving the strategy. And I think that for us, that means that in small teams, when business and IT work together, it is a kind of squads that we have, and I'll explain a bit more, you will see that there's an enormous amount of interaction and that helps people to understand what would be the next step. And I think that is fundamental. And then the question becomes, what kind of change as an organization do we need? And I think the change is not inflicted by us, but it's more or less inflicted by our customers, by people like you. You all use WhatsApp, you all use Airbnb, you all use Netflix, and basically you see these organizations that are scalable, that never have outages, and that have a phenomenal website. You know, they do stuff that the typical banks don't do. And basically what I see is in these organizations, three things they do different. Number one, I think they work truly end-to-end agile. Number two, they invest in talent. Talent makes a difference. And number three, I think they have a bit of a different architecture. And we are trying to catch up. And why? Because our end customers do not understand why they should accept that a bank does not deliver the same kind of value that they get from Netflix or from Airbnb or many of these other countries. So customers are putting a lot of pressure on us, and that's good. We are forced to change. If you would, from a more banking point of view, you'll also see that low interest rates are forcing us to change. We are in a sector that is under immense pressure, and pressure is good. Pressure is cool, because it makes you change. You don't have the luxury to just remain stable. If we are not careful, we are out of business in a couple of years. We have to fight. And I think that that kind of mentality is actually the best mentality that you can ever find. So every one of you who works in an organization that is too rich or is not under pressure, I would say quit and go work somewhere else, because you will not innovate. You will not, you know, reinvent yourself. And at least we see that our customers, people like you as banking customers, are putting a lot of stress to us, and that's what I like. So what did it mean for ING? Basically, we had three big steps that we took. The first step was in 2007, 2010. That was what we called Tango. We merged the Postbank and the ING Bank. And basically, just from an IT point of view, we were two extremely traditional waterfall companies with enormous amount of PIDs. And I think we basically accounted for 5% of the total revenues of Microsoft because of the amount of documents we wrote. And basically, and you know, for me it's just amazing that we accomplished this in an organization that was truly about coordinating and aligning and all this other kind of managerial bullshit, you know, but we made it happen. It actually succeeded. And then we basically stepped into a new period. We had the two banks being merged, and then we had to step up, we had to start automating. And what you saw is that it was a nightmare with us. Some of you who might be old Postbank customers, you might remember that, for example, if you wanted to do stuff, you had to go to the post office and get this kind of a brochure that you had to fill in, and you had to fill in 8 pages. For example, if a family member would die, you had to fill in what to do with the account for the deceased customer. And on 7 or 8 of these pages, you had to fill in, on every individual page, you had to fill in your name and your bank account number and all kind of stuff that the bank already knew. And why was it? Because this booklet was teared apart in our back office, and this sheet was sent to securities, that sheet was sent to savings, this sheet was sent to mortgages. And basically we were making sure that it was a nightmare. So the first time right of these documents was about, I would say, 4%. an average Dutch citizen who had to fill in these forms had to do so 3 times, because you get the form back and stating on page 9 you have forgotten to once more sign. And then basically after this shitty process that took perhaps 60-80 days, we had an outbound call center that called basically the erven, what is it, the people that got the money, and asked them, we would like you that the money would remain in ING. What can we do to help you to become a fantastic customer? Well, I can tell you the impact of that outbound call center was zero. So basically we had to improve. We had to redesign processes. We had to think about first time right. And what you then see with first time right is that also our commercial guys, in terms of we enabled their vision, the commercial guys, first of all, start to put the exact same brochure on the internet and said, what a phenomenal service. Well, it's not. It's not. You know, if you know the account of your customer, why do you ask it? So basically, you have to really rethink the entire way that you do your processes. And my colleague, Bart Slapman, the COO, started an enormous project. He called it the washing lanes, the wasstraten, where he basically one by one started to improve these processes. And then IT started. And IT started basically 5 years ago, we will do agile. And the honest answer is, and I should be a bit careful, I have some time, because we started early, but basically I'll give you a bit of a flavor on how ING worked. Let's assume that you wanted to do a new mortgage system. We do a new mortgage system. Then you go and work in PowerPoint because there needs to be a business case. And the business case is there, and the business case has basically 2 big promises. Our revenues will explode with this new system, and our cost will implode with this system. This is just a phenomenal business case. It's all in PowerPoint, so it's true. So you go to the management board banking. So basically you go to the CEO. And you know the CEO, he looks at these numbers, and basically the first thing that he does, and especially his colleague, the CFO, the head of finance, they take down 50% of the revenues and they take down 50% of the cost savings, and then it becomes a bit more realistic, and then it still makes sense. So the guys are not going to argue with you whether the business case is correct, but basically they have one question. They have one question. Why do you think you can do it this time? Because we have a track record of 10 of these big monsters, and you see that with the government, you see that with the, you know, why do you think you can do it this time? And then the answer is always very simple. We have a new project director, his name is Peter Jacobs, and he's really a smart guy, he's phenomenal. This guy will solve all your problems. Look at him, he's not wearing a suit today, but normally he is. And so this is amazing what he can do for you. And basically the management board banking feels a bit with their back against the wall, because how often can you say no? So then after a couple of weeks, they said, okay, let's do it. But we want to be on top of this, we want to have control. Control is what we will offer you, transparency all over. So let's start. So what does the project director do? This was the waterfall timer. The waterfall time was, the project director would basically, first of all, he would hire 4 project managers reporting to him. And these project managers, they start on Monday morning. And the first thing these project managers do is they go to the HR website. And in the HR website, they look, how do I become a project director? And what's this? A project director is very good at managing people. So the first thing these 4 guys do is individually also recruit 4 guys. So we have a Christmas tree, about 20 guys coordinating and aligning the project. And nothing has happened yet. Then on Tuesday, they have their kickoff meeting with the 20 guys. And basically, with the 20 guys, they have to come up with one simple, basically, what is the impact? Our project needs a name. And they give their project a name. And the name, and I'm not kidding, this is ING, the name is Globe. I can tell you, every project director who calls his project Globe should have been fired on the same day. Because the word overscoping is intrinsic in the name of your project. So we have 20 guys basically going to do Globe. Then they go to the mortgages guys and they bring a bottle of champagne and say, we have green light, we can make this happen, we're going to fight for this new mortgage system. And what does the commercial guy do? They will say, how are we going to work now? So basically in the next 3 years we will deliver this, and we have a very structured approach. We had to promise this, and that's called waterfall. And the good thing about waterfall is that in the first 3 months we'll do our requirement analysis, and then we do 6 months of design, then we do 12 months of implementation, and then the project goes live. So the commercial people think, so this is the 3 months where we do our requirements. Yes, this is the 3 months of requirements. And basically we understand that we will then be underway for 3 years. Yes, that's correct. And we will spend 50 million. Yes, that's correct. That sounds fantastic. And let's assume that this project works. Let's assume this will all go well. what is the likelihood that we will get, after this project, yet another 10 million to improve? Yeah, that's potentially not the case, because after mortgages, the money goes to savings. So we know that this is the big project that we're going to make happen. Yes, this is the big project we're going to make it happen. So what we will ensure is that all requirements known to mankind are going to put on the table. So after a couple of weeks, you see with 20 guys, the project is called Globe. You have requirements that are, you know, they are endless, and we have not yet started. Then we come to the architecture and the design. We do the design ourselves, and then we zip the PowerPoint. We had to invent a program called WeTransfer, because the PowerPoint was too big to send over to India, and we hope that someone else bakes the CD-ROM with the code. We wait for a year, the CD-ROM comes back, we press on setup.execute, and nothing works. You know, and whatever works was not intended. And so that was a bit of the, of course I'm exaggerating a bit, but that was traditional how these big projects work. And that is fundamentally wrong, and that should be fundamentally stopped. So we basically said 5 years ago to our commercial colleagues, we will do Agile. And commercial colleagues basically said, we don't care. We've lost all trust in how IT delivers. So whether you do Agile or whatever you do, I don't care. As long as you don't bother us. And it can't go, you know, it can't go even worse. So by doing that, we started to do Agile, and what it is basically we said, Agile is for everyone. So Agile is on the mainframe, Agile is on the HP non-stop, Agile is in mobile banking, Agile is for everyone. And over the years that happened, we basically saw that there was an enormous improvement. Why? All these coordinating and aligning functions were taken out, but most importantly, we came to the conclusion that waterfall is actually the best way of making software if you can meet three simple conditions. Your customer know upfront what they want. The second one is the techies know at day one how to build it, and the world doesn't change while you're doing your project. And these three conditions never happened at ING. So basically we started to do Agile and small teams doing impact, and the biggest upside of changing into Agile was that we stopped with all these handovers. The guys normally doing the requirements were not the same guys doing the testing. There were all these handovers, and therefore we had all these documents controlling the handovers, and all the handovers were out. But if the handovers are out, you go with small teams, and these small teams together work for impact. So there was an enormous vision, we need to do Agile. And then a year and a half ago, our commercial colleague said, that Peter, we've been looking at this phenomenal website called agilemanifesto.org, but true Agile means business and IT together. So let's fully rechange the organization of the bank into a fully end-to-end Agile way of working, and that is the project we call Rio. So let's start a movie, and I'll show you a bit of the organizational model and how ING now works in terms of being Agile.
Clients have an increasing number of options in contacting those they do business with. Businesses that must be available 24/7 and provide relevant, top-notch, personal service. That applies to all commercial enterprises, including banks. Digital innovators such as Spotify and Netflix are at the forefront of such developments when it comes to tailoring their service to client needs. They have a clear concept of corporate culture and a defined approach to collaboration processes. They believe firmly in the methodology called Agile. For ING, they are important sources of inspiration in establishing a new way of working together, a new level of servicing clients. The new way of working calls for quicker reactions to changing client needs, less interdepartmental passing of the baton, fewer coordination meetings, more room for initiative, and higher levels of responsibilities for teams and individuals. So, how does it work? The fundamental unit in our future head office organization is the squad. Squads are self-steering, autonomous teams of up to 9 people, responsible end-to-end for their own specific customer-related mission. Squads are built around different disciplines, different areas of expertise, and different backgrounds. For example, the squad mortgage application concerns itself with developing and implementing the most customer-friendly and most efficient way of moving from first mortgage submission to final approval. And the Squad search engine is dedicated to developing the most customer-friendly and effective search engine for our various digital channels. In Squads, you can expect to find colleagues from marketing, product management, formula management, data analysis, user experience, and IT. Sometimes more of the one or more of the other, depending on the nature of the squad's mission. Within each squad, product ownership is assigned to one squad member. This product owner is responsible for what a squad does, is in charge of the backlog and to-do list, and determines priorities. This does not mean the product owner is the boss. Coordination between members of the same discipline takes place inside chapters. There is, for example, a chapter Data Analytics, a chapter Customer Journey Mortgages, a chapter Product Management Processes. Chapters determine how jobs should be tackled. The chapter lead is ultimately responsible for this and also represents the hierarchy for squad members, taking responsibility for personal development, coaching, and the performance management cycle of individual squad members. The chapter lead will perform these duties in addition to their regular day-to-day job in their own squad. But if squads are self-steering and autonomous, how can we ensure coordination between squads? That is where tribes come in. A tribe is a collection of squads with interconnected missions. There is a tribe securities and private banking, a tribe mortgage services, etc. As a rule, a tribe contains fewer than 150 people, coordinated by the tribe lead, who, although not the traditional boss of all tribe members, ensures that knowledge and insights are shared, establishes priorities, and allocates available budgets. The tribe lead also forms the interface with other tribes. And that's it. Well, almost. There is one more vital role. That of Agile Coach, the person who coaches individuals and squads and who helps them to grow and prosper. That, in a nutshell, is how most of ING head office will function in the future. Most, but not all. The Agile approach involves flexibility in adapting to the needs of the moment. The forming of tribes is very much a tailor-made thing, dependent on specific goals and circumstances. And that is an approach that may not suit all business functions, and so a degree of trial and error will help us establish what does and does not work in practice. The agile approach is in itself agile and not cast in iron. That is what makes it such a valuable tool in achieving our goals.
So you've seen basically how we have shifted to agile. We in the Netherlands now have about 14 tribes. We have 300 squads, and these squads are approximately 60-70% of the people in the squads are IT guys. And it's my role to ensure that how these IT guys work. So what you will see in the transformation that is that agile way of working has been very important, and an organizational model that was inspired by Spotify that we've put in place. Those are two pillars of our transformation. Now let's go to the more techie ones. And before we go to the techie one, I'll go to the... So we have four big transformation pillars. One, agile. And two, the organizational model. We have the techie one. I will zoom in, continuous delivery. But the most important one, I think it's people. And what did we do with people? Last year, again, a bit of the flavor on how these large organizations work, I looked at engineers. And I saw in my HR house, we have engineers that are in salary skill 8, 9, 10, 11, and 12. And then you ask your organization and you ask HR, what is the difference between an engineer in salary skill 8 and salary skill 12? And the answer you get is quality. I said, that's super, quality. And by the way, how do we measure quality? Yeah, that's a good question. How do we measure quality? So let's go back to our HR booklets. And these booklets were written in the time of Waterfall. And it was a very simple answer. Good engineers work on large projects. Not good engineers work on small projects. Okay, you can't be more wrong, I think, than this. And not because we don't do projects anymore, because Agile is not about projects, but even in the time that you had projects, this is just nonsense. This is nonsense. So then we read, this is nonsense. So you go further. You say to the guys, well, how do we measure quality? And they say, productivity. That's, you know, that sounds okay. And how do we measure productivity? Number of lines of code per month. I think that is the most scary nonsense you can have in state. Because what one phenomenal guy does in three lines needs a novice to do in, you know, at this, you know, I've had an example. I'll give you one example. We had someone applying for a job. And the guy applying for a job was being asked in his interview, how would you compute whether the number 121 in Java is a prime number? And he said, that's very simple. You do, if the number A can be divided by 2, then return false. Else if number can be divided by 3, then return false. Else if, so you start to continue, and 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and then the guy was doing the interview said, you're forgetting 10. Yeah, indeed, I'm forgetting 10. So if numbers of lines of code would say something about productivity, we would be bankrupt. And so that's also not good. And again, you see that what ING tries to do is we don't try to invent anything. There are smarter people in the world. So for the organizational model, we looked at Spotify. For Agile, we got it out of the book. And what do you now do for talent, talent recognition? How do people honestly feel that you declare that talent makes a difference? And what we did is we looked at Netflix. And what does Netflix do? Netflix has based its HR policy on the Dreyfus brothers. And the Dreyfus brothers were two guys in the artificial intelligence domain in the late 80s of the last century. And what they basically said, we have 5 levels, from novice to expert. And basically the only thing we do, if we want to see a proxy for quality, we want to see how do people deal with knowledge. Are people basically absorbing knowledge? Are they applying knowledge? Or are they sharing knowledge? So the novice guy, who's just a fresh guy, he gets tasks. He is even being pointed, these are the tutorials you need to follow. He basically gets assignment on what he needs to do. And then you become a bit more mature and you get to structure your own work a bit more. And still you need coaching if stuff goes wrong, up to the level where you're competent. If you're competent, you still go to classroom training, but you go to the advanced levels of classroom training. You can be the guy structuring the tasks within your team. If you're more on the proficient level, you don't go to classroom training, but you give classroom training. You go to conferences, basically, to the software circus to get new knowledge in. And basically, by looking on how do people deal with knowledge, we came to, a very strong kind of framework that helps people to understand where do you stand. And then the question is, how much of which do you need? And my honest answer is, we need fantastic people. We need proficient and expert people. We want to grow at the top. We need the true engineers that have the freedom to develop. And where it is, our finance guys used to look, a Java developer who cost me 16 euros an hour is always better than the one who cost me 18 euros an hour. We said this entire price per unit, per FTE, it's all nonsense. Because inevitably, I think it is true, that the experts and the proficients deliver much more productivity, although you don't measure it, but fundamentally they are much better capable of making the next shift happen than a volume of 200 people that are every morning questioning themselves, what are these characters doing on this device in front of me? And then basically you see that there is an enormous, I think, fight for talent, and we are trying to do everything we can to get engineers in-house to help us. Help us with new technologies, help us with doing so. So basically, now I've explained to you the 3 pillars, and now I'll go to the cloud and to the more techy stuff. But basically, Agile has been extremely important, the organizational model has been extremely important, and the next step is recognition of talent, and the talent truly makes a difference, engineering talent. So you don't have to go to the back, you know, you have to be a decent Java developer to become a manager in ING, or Scala, or whatever you like. So also the managerial layers, you have to have an IT background. If you don't understand IT, go work somewhere else. Don't bother us. That's basically, I think, the polite version. Now the fourth one. And the fourth one, really, so I'll include a bit with one slide on what we have to do with Agile. And I think that Agile is fun. Agile is all the way. We need talented people to make this happen. And now I think I'll go to the IT part. What is the IT part? When we started Agile, as I explained to you, we did it everywhere. And now let's zoom in on one of our biggest monsters in the bank. And the biggest monster is a core bank. And why is it a big monster? Because all the accounts are in there, all the balances are in there. This is a piece of software. And the piece of software has not been built by us. We have bought it. And we have a good relation with that vendor for 10 years. So even in the waterfall time. And in the wonderful time, and when we started to do the migration to Agile, people asked us, so let's do Agile. Cool, let's do Agile. And I asked the team, how often do we get a new version from this vendor? And my organization told me, Peter, it's 5 times a year. And I said, cool. And what time does it take, basically, if you get a new release, to test it and to deploy it? And they told me, Peter, it costs us 11 days. I said, I'm so glad that sprints in Agile are 14 days, because at least we have 3 days left to make some cool stuff happening, if it takes 11 days to test and deploy it. So we basically found out you get nowhere with declaring that you want to be Agile if you don't invest, basically, in automating your IT. And then we found out a nice book by Jess Humble, Continuous Delivery. Is there anyone who never heard of Continuous Delivery? Cool. Cool, so that's good. So we have invested an enormous amount. So these days we're doing about, I think, 15 to 20,000 deployments per month. And all deployments in the bank are automated. I think the version control in GitLab and Jenkins and all the tool suite that you all know have been put in place. And that has been our fourth model. The fourth model, the fourth pillar of our transformation was continuous delivery. So Agile, the organizational model, the talent recognition, and continuous delivery. But continuous delivery, we've invested a lot in that over the last 3 years. And now we're reaching basically, I would say, almost the end of what is feasible by us with that. And it has brought us an enormous improvement, but it's not good enough. It has been good, it has been nice, but we need to step up, and we need to step up significantly. And that's where cloud starts to play a role, because I think I'm going to share a bit with you what we're going to do in with cloud. We believe that the first bank that commoditized compliance and automation will have a significant competitive advantage over fintechs. Let me do this, because this is a big slogan. I said that in continuous delivery, we've been automating IT processes. But the IT processes itself remained pretty much the same. What I mean by that is, yes, you have automated the deployment, but you've automated the manual process that used to be called deployment. So I look back at the times when we did Waterfall with CoreBank, when we did a change in production, then at 11 o'clock or 12 o'clock, at 1 o'clock at night in the data center, in candlelight, people were typing in 80 pages of Unix statements to get the system up and running. If you by candlelight with two engineers at 3 o'clock in the morning are typing in 80 pages, and you have to do that in production, you have to do that in acceptance, and in your DR location, you know for sure that after 3 deployments, these systems don't look the same anymore, because people make mistakes. And the automation of the deployment has helped us to get much better control and much more speed into doing this. So that was good. So, but the entire existing IT processes have been automated. But as a bank, we are in a difficult situation. Why? The regulator is on top of us. And what does the regulator require from us? They require us to be in control. And I'll just highlight a bit what does it mean. It means that if you do a state change on the virtual machine, for example, you do a new version of your core bank, that you can prove that the state change was intended. That you can also prove that there were no state changes unintended. That means that you have security monitoring everywhere in place. That means that you have technical state compliance everywhere in place. That means that you have these nasty SOL matrix in place that define who has access to what machine. It means that you have to do constant patching. And all these nightmare risk processes have ensured that I have seen that great people have left ING. They loved the spirit of ING and becoming more agile, but this kind of compliance and risk framework were never resolved. And it's still all manual, or now a bit more automated, but fundamentally we have been automating existing processes. More importantly, in ING we had a big difference between infrastructure and with application domain. And when we look at external people that we admire, we of course also look at Azure or at Amazon or all the cloud providers. But if you're an Amazon, you're a company that there's a boundary and that sells its products to independent customers. So there is a very strict boundary between what is Amazon and what is you, what is ING. I think in ING we have the luxury potentially not to introduce this boundary. And I will show you that there are some upsides in having your own infrastructure, your own cloud infrastructure, that go way beyond what an external cloud provider could ever offer you, because we can integrate better. And they are very much about being in control. So where the continuous delivery has delivered speed by automating what we do today, I think we go to a new era, and this is in R&D. So what did we see? What are the big ticket issues that we have? We lack traceability. We lack traceability on many aspects. The fundamental traceability on everything. So that doesn't say that we don't have traceability, but we can and should improve in multiple areas. I think that the autonomy of the screen, we have a lot of waiting times, and still waiting times, and all kinds of waiting times are an impediment. People have to wait for firewall changes, they have to wait for the infrastructure to come up, they have to wait for patch management. I want to continue with the next version of Docker, yeah, but I need this version of the underlying operating system, and all these kind of dependencies are in there. I think we are ineffective in the total control, because what you do, for example, with security event monitoring, you start to think, what could a cybercrime guy ever do to us? And of course, that you monitor. But do you know that you've monitored all? And that's a big question. Are you in shape there? And then there is a lot of evidence gathering. And the evidence gathering is a nightmare to our organization, because many people have to look in all kind of logs to basically present what they've done to the ECB. It's not automated. I think there is no integrated automation. We do not have the concept of the full stack in place. And I will start to explain more about the full stack steps that we're going to do. I think global collaboration, there is so much uniqueness in how we work across the different business units that a collaboration between ING Belgium and ING Netherlands, you know, it suffered from the fact that we don't use the same methods and the same approach in getting there. And I think that we are not competing there. And I think that for many of the fintechs, that they will start to see, if you introduce yourself in the world of banking, you will get the regulation for free. But this is tough. This is tough. It is different from setting up a nice website for the Efteling. It is different. And so basically what we saw is fundamental issues by not having a full stack and by not having the power that we actually changed our total way of working. And now let's look at least the principles of the new way of working that's being designed in our R&D. And for sure, I think that 80% of the ING people that are sitting in this audience don't even know that this is happening and that will be coming if we are capable of proving that it works. And I have high hopes, otherwise I wouldn't dare to present it to you. But it's not there. So basically what we're going to say is we're going to introduce an assembly pipeline. And what I'm going to do is I'm first going to go to the next slide and then I'll go back to this one. And let's see. What are the big principles of what we're going to do? Whom of you recognizes all of those principles? At least, I should start. So at least there is some new stuff for many people. Outcomes over impositions. Our entire regulatory framework today is about impositions, and they are a nightmare. We should go to outcomes. I'll give you a good example. An outcome is that you state to yourself, I want customer data extremely well protected. That would be an outcome. An imposition is you shall rule. You shall not use production data in your test environment. You shall not use production data in your test environment. That's a statement you shall do. That's a typical example of an imposition. And the question that we have, if we now look at SaaS solutions, take a SaaS solution, take Salesforce, I don't know, take an individual SaaS solution, and you think, for a SaaS solution provider, if we have agreed that they are very good at protecting our customer data in production, and we would instantiate an instance on that SaaS solution to be used for testing, what is now fundamentally the difference in protecting production or testing? It's zero. So why would you state to the IT organization that you shall not use production data in a test environment? So basically we have too many rules that articulate how engineers should work that are very much a burden to these engineers. You should give engineers the freedom to think about what is the objective, what is the outcome I want to reach, and then ask the engineers, how do you think we can get there? So basically, because if you don't do that, you're going to look at a fully stateless API and still stating, you shall make backups. Well, what are you going to backup? If the code is in GitLab, you have a continuous delivery pipeline that can instantiate a new instance any minute, why would you ever be backup the VM? Look at our storage domain, how big we are in terms of storage, is because of all these kind of impositions that come from the top that should be fundamentally, I think, blown away, and you should give the engineers the freedom to think, what are the outcomes that you want to achieve? standard way of working. I live that. The biggest one I want to talk about today is shift left. Shift left together with the immutable server pattern, because here it's truly about cloud. And this is, I think, going to be the fundamental shift that we have. Shift left, basically, who is not familiar with shift left? I'm happy to explain. Good. We come from a world where we say you start as a developer in your IDE, you upload code to Git, you compile the code after it's being in Git, you bring it to Artifactory as an executable, then you do some functional testing and you do finally the deployment. And let's assume that this is the customer journey of the code. This is basically the process on how code comes alive. What shift left means is do everything maximum as early as possible. A typical implementation of a shift left paradigm, doing stuff as early as possible, I'll give you two examples. One is test-driven development. You do the testing, you bring it all the way up front. But also, for example, whom of you would say, I don't need unit testing because I do functional testing at the end? If you don't do unit testing and you do functional testing at the end, that would be a nice example of shift right. And then you have the downside, your cost of a regret starts to grow. Because the amount of effort you have to put in there, if you solve it, if it's already on that side, is much more than if you would have tackled it, the issue, in the beginning. And this is so model-driven testing. On testing, this is quite a normal paradigm. But now I bring this to continuous delivery. What we typically do, we have said, we come from a world where infra and apps were quite basically different departments. So what we do is we say we first provision the infra machines. After we've received the infra machines, like the VMs from Amazon, then we have this fully continuous delivery pipeline that starts to inject code on that machine. And if it's injecting code on that machine, the first thing that you do is that you have a Puppet agent or a Chef agent or a Nolio agent, or I don't know what kind of release automation you use. You have that agent on the VM. And basically, every time you basically make a state change, you do that fully automatically on the existing infra. If you do patch management from the infra side, you update the operating system. And yes, you've automated that. But now let's do the following, and this is where the immutable server pattern comes in. If you would now state the following, let's stop all this and make sure that at T0, so only at T0, you don't instantiate a virtual machine that you hand over for people to use, but you would instantiate not only the virtual machine, but on top of the virtual machine you would put all your middleware, like Tomcat. On top of that, you would immediately also assemble the EAR files, you would assemble everything, you would do the API calls to the firewalls, you would do an API calls to the load balancers, whether you use Zookeeper or F5s or Curator or Console, or I don't know what kind of stuff you're using. If you would do all these APIs at minute one, at T0, you would assemble the entire stuff. You know what you can then do? You throw away the SSH daemon. So you make the server fundamentally immutable afterwards. No one can ever touch it anymore. If you need to do patching, you can't patch it because no one can access the virtual machine anymore. You have to reassemble a new instance with the latest version of the code. If you have an incident, you fix the incident in your code and you reassemble a new instance. So basically, it will be fundamentally impossible to ever touch the machine anymore. That's the concept of immutable server pattern. And if you go there to this immutable server pattern, would you still need security event monitoring? Well, the fundamental answer is no. Would you still need technical state compliance monitoring? The answer is no. So you've taken a total different way of getting to the same outcome. So you don't state anymore, the imposition is you shall do security event monitoring, but basically you shall ensure that no one can touch the virtual machine. And that is where ING, at least in our R&D department, we are trying to get a full stack. So cloud, non-cloud, everything in between there. And how does this, for example, relate to Docker? Many people have seen Docker as also some great things. So as I said, continued delivery is all about speed, speed, speed. I've explained to you the assembly pipeline is about being in control. That is ensuring that all these risk frameworks go out, but this requires an enormous engineering effort. Eh? Because you need to spin up new assembled VMs within seconds. So your operating system needs to be less than 100 megabytes. You know, if your OS is too big, you fail. It becomes too slow. You need to be able to do that 300 times. So basically, it's a fundamental shift that we're trying to bring there. But now let's zoom in a bit more. What is now the role of Docker in there? Docker, at least in my view, has made two big promises. Number one, basically a separation between infra and the application world. And that is a good one, eh? Because separation between that means less dependency. Less dependency means more speed. That's basically the same with continuous delivery. Continuous delivery, we automated the processes. With Docker, we basically ensure that there are no dependencies anymore. But if you then go further with Docker, the second thing you get with the Kubernetes or the Mesos or the Swarm or I don't know what kind of stuff you are using or playing around with, you get basically the concept of horizontally scalability, and you get this kind of the Docker families. And that's also still good. And now Docker has been evolving a lot, and you will see with the traditional cloud providers, what they provide to you, like an Amazon or a Google or those kind of guys, is they provide you a hardened operating system, a totally hardened operating system, on which you can deploy your Docker containers. Like in Red Hat, it's the Atomic one. Eh? And I think it's good, because they've gone so far, these guys, that they dare to make it immutable. So the operating system is immutable. But the problem is, they can't do the full end-to-end stack. So your Docker container can be as mutable as hell. And as soon as you make it mutable, you have technical state compliance monitoring, security event monitoring, you have SOL matrix, you have the entire shebang. So what we try to do is ensure that with the assembly pipeline concept, this could also instantiate Docker. So basically, you would then have the Docker container at T0 being fundamentally, totally being assembled, and you provision that to an Atomic OS. Because one of the scary things that also you should be looking for is that you don't start to basically stable. It would be a bit bad if you have, and I've seen examples. I've seen a hypervisor on top of the hypervisor, a Red Hat 7 on top of the Red Hat 7, the Docker server on top of, of course, Docker server is less than a megabyte, but anyway, the Docker daemon. Then on top of that, the Docker image. In the Docker image, a nice Red Hat 8. Why? Infra doesn't support Red Hat 8, I need Red Hat 8, boom. Is that safe? No. There is a reason why our infrastructure guys don't support it yet. At least, you know, and that cascading that you build everything up on each other in Docker, you can do it, and of course it's very, very ugly. You shouldn't. So basically what I wanted to show you is that, you know, many of the infra guys are always thinking we make ourselves redundant in the years because we can never compete with a company like Google. And I would state that's only partially true, because I think that fundamentally, especially these large organizations like ING, are very much helped if you would take a full end-to-end stack view. And if you would start the entire shebang, where the concept of immutable server patterns is for me one of the most beautiful I've ever seen. But the only thing is, if you have to deviate once, so if there is one line of code you need to adjust after you've provisioned, then you're out. As soon as it becomes mutable, you have all the risk controls frameworks again in there. And what does it mean in terms of a shift for our infrastructure department? Infra is software. Infra guys need to be software engineers. If you're not a software engineer, if you're not a software developer, you have to basically retrain yourself or find a new job as a marketeer or I don't know what you're going to do. But infra is about software. I think that's the second, I think, fundamental shift that we're seeing at the moment. So a bit of a conclusion, and then I would like to ask you questions. Conclusion is the transformation of ING on four pillars. Agile, the organizational model based on Spotify, drive this in terms of talent recognition and continuous delivery. And with continuous delivery, we've made a very, very big step, but that is we've discovered only half of what we need, because we need to go to full stack engineering on the cloud, on the concept of shift left, making it truly, truly immutable. So that's at least my spirit to you for today. I hope you liked it, and I'm very open to any kind of questions or remarks.
Okay, any questions for Peter? Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Hello. Thanks very much for the talk. It was very interesting. I have a question about, you moved away from your traditional way of working to this new way of working. You obviously have teams that do traditional application management. They're responsible maybe for the runtime environment. and as you move to immutable server pattern, can you maybe explain what happened to these guys? Are they moved into the DevOps team to change from online management, online system management, to more offline system management early in the CD process?
I think it's a good question. Let me ask you a question. Who thinks that women can program better than men? Okay, at least. I would say the majority doesn't. Who would think that men can program better than women? Also, not convinced. So basically we say that whether you're a good engineer or not, you know, at least your gender is not a discriminating factor. And who thinks that you can do agile on mobile development, APIs, Polymer, I don't know what you use, but you can't do agile on a mainframe? Who thinks that the technology drives how you work? So we at least have the same agreement. I had that fundamental. I see many, many, many of my competitors doing it awfully wrong. I can't stay there. You know, I talk a lot with Gartner, for example, one of these big consulting companies in IT, and they even have a word for this. They call this the bipolar, bimodal IT. I call it the bipolar IT, but I think they call it the bimodal IT. But they basically say, agile you do at the front, and basically waterfall you do for your more traditional setting, and that's just nonsense. If you honestly think that your customers do not know at day one what they need, your techies do not know at day one how to build it, and the world does change while you're doing your project, if this is hindering you, go for agile. If I would be forced with a gun on my head that I had to do waterfall somewhere, I'd rather do it at waterfall in the introduction of the fingerprint on the mobile app than that I do waterfall on my core banking systems, because as soon as it becomes complex, you need basically this rhythm of doing this. So there has been in ING no discrimination whether you work on the HP non-stop or on the mainframe, if you work on COBOL, Scala, TIBCO, whatever you work on. So agile is everywhere. That has also meant that there simply are no teams anymore doing maintenance. They don't exist. Everyone is in squads. 100% of my IT guys are in squads. Of course, not everyone, because I have a personal assistant and she is not in the squad. But all the engineers are in the squads. Dev and ops in one team. So basically, you do it really in one team. And so basically, if they would find out there is less ops work to do, because we have this fantastic concept, immutable server pattern, I hope that they're all going to feel extremely lucky, because there is more time to do dev and to innovate further. The one thing is that I'll be a bit harsh on that, I think that you need to be a very good software developer to build, for example, this concept of an assembly pipeline. And I would say, in general, given the past, at least 5 years ago it was the case, the dev guys in ING were a bit stronger than the ops guys, but that was also because they were never allowed to basically do the programming. Over the last years, to bring them together in one and the same team, that is gone. You will see that, that is gone. And what it does mean, and that is sometimes difficult, if you look at my driver's model, especially the very, very strong guys, like the proficient Scala guys, or the experts on, name something cool and they're experts, they have insufficiently invested in the full stack engineering. Every engineer needs to understand the stack. They need to understand basically in which domain do I sit, where are my firewalls, how am I connected to a load balancer. And the view that you can get away with, you don't have to be an expert in everything, but I'm an expert in Scala and I assume that this will happen by itself, that is a bit that you got to use. Agile will force you to broaden your role. You're only with 5 ITers in a team and you have to do everything. So there is no department anymore for maintenance, functions are being broadened, we need full stack engineers. For as much from the infra side as from the application side.
Thank you. Any more? Yes, in the back.
What do you think about people who claim that you should just buy a platform as a service product and it will do it all for you?
Yeah, it depends a bit on your vision, eh? No, seriously, so for example, take a high school. The core competence of a high school is not to be, in the core of the strategy is to educate people in a classroom where there's a teacher and some students. So if those guys would say, I don't have the willingness, I don't even have the appetite to have IT driving my business, I can honestly understand that. and that these guys would say, I tried to buy the box that does everything for me and I don't need to be more, I think I can imagine that. If you would do that as a bank, you know, at least I would not like to work for that bank. I have a total different view. I think that IT is driving basically what we're doing these days.
The main claim made by people pushing PaaS is that it enables IT to take a more forward and central role because they focus on applications, not infrastructure.
Yeah, I think that's true. And what I like best is, so basically if you look at the concept, such a concept of an assembly pipeline, then the question is, should the assembly pipeline be engineered by application guys or should it be engineered by infrastructure guys? My fundamental view is both, a joint team that builds this. If you will then look how much power do you need from infrastructure and how much power do you need from the application side, I think the power from the application side is perhaps a bit less. But then you have your infrastructure people building out this platform that can be consumed by the multiple squads. So in that sense, this is not... But do I see external companies offering stuff like this? The honest answer is no at the moment.
Okay, anyone? Yes.
Thank you very much for your keynote. I just want to make sure I heard something correctly. Were you suggesting that the immutable software pattern and the lack of an SSH daemon means you don't have to do security event monitoring?
No, basically what I've said is as soon as you would remove all access to the virtual machine, if you would remove all access to the virtual machine, then at least on the operating system level, you can ask yourself the question, what is the value of monitoring that? Security event monitoring, when it comes down to transaction flows and customer flows, of course it needs to be there, but at least it helps to resolve specific items that you in one way would or not would have to monitor. That's basically my view.
Thank you.
You agree? What's your perspective?
I don't agree. I really think, yes, you reduce your attack surface a little bit, but it doesn't mean you don't have an attack surface.
Yeah, but then the attack surface is most likely going to be on the middleware components that you've built on top of the operating system.
If you're lucky.
If you're lucky, good. Yeah.
Yeah, done with that?
Yes.
Thanks. So you told about a lot of changes, like changes for the company, for moving to Agile, a lot of other stuff. And I wonder, so on PowerPoint level, it kind of works really well. And in practice, you see that a lot of people are just not able to make it to the end of the journey. So, with more autonomy comes taking responsibility, not everybody's able to do that. So, can you tell a bit about the challenges you had?
Yes.
Because that must have been a pretty big group also. And what happened to them? How did you help them? Yeah. What were the biggest challenges?
I think it's an excellent question. And basically, the question you should, basically, in my view, separate into two questions. Number one, I at least give you my perspective on why I don't like waterfall. Some of you might have a different opinion. But now, and I try to give you at least two, three fundamental problems with waterfall. And then the question becomes, are there fundamental issues with Agile? So they are not related to a maturity level, but they are related basically to what Agile is. And I think there are two fundamental challenges with Agile. Number one, Agile is so much about getting software to production that if you're not careful, your innovation becomes incremental innovation. And you have to organize for big step innovations. That would be my one answer. The second answer is, there is so much autonomy in the teams that if we don't organize for alignment, we will start a restaurant in 6 months. And that's the second thing. You have to organize for alignment across these teams to ensure that we still have something called a joint vision on how we push forward. And I think that, not to be rude, I'm a big fan of Spotify. I like it personally, and I'm also a big fan of how they work. But you know, how many of you use Spotify? And how many of you has been amazed by the innovations over the last 12 months?
That's over weekly, isn't it?
That's
over weekly, isn't
it? Good. But basically what you see, Agile is, if you're not careful, it's all about, let's make it not that dark, but a bit less dark, and a new button, and yet another button. And the organization is crowded with 1,000 people there now, right? So that means basically, you have to be careful for those two things, and you have to address them. And I think the second question to you is basically, in your transformation, what are the big challenges in transforming them? And I basically think with transformation, there is a couple of things. Number one, you need to have a vision that people actually support and like. And I think with the engineering population, basically you tell the engineering population, guys, let's play Champions League. And in this Champions League, there are always three, four guys in every soccer team that state, yes, we're going to play soccer Champions League. There are always five people that are questioned, they like the journey, but they are a bit afraid, can I join that? Am I good enough to play the Champions League? And there are a group of people that know, this year it ends for me, because, you know, I used to be, we call it functional behavior, what is it, functional maintenance, or that kind of stuff, not really IT-savvy people. And not very much IT-savvy people in an IT organization know that it ends. So, but you cannot do change without taking tough decisions. And therefore you've seen within ING there has been an enormous restructuring going on, because fundamentally everyone who was in the third league that said this is nothing, I can't join, they were asked to leave the organization. For the remaining bees, we've immediately started big kind of ING IT academies where ING people teach ING people. So we did not source it out, or we did not, but basically we asked the best people, teach each other. And that academy has been at least instrumental in getting trust and the attitude and the quality of the staff up. But you will see that it converges more to talent. And that's not for everyone. That is a very honest statement. Yeah. So there has been a lot of restructuring, and I think that many of you potentially have heard that or not, that there are very many vacancies, but at the same time, there has also been a significant layoff has happened over the last years. Please.
Hi, Peter. Other way. This way. Right, your right.
My right.
Hey, thanks for coming. Great talk. You compared the Efteling to ING. Well, I recently booked a holiday at the Efteling. It was fucking complex.
Okay. No, it's not about complex. Is it regulated?
Okay, my question to you is, you just touched on redundancies, and obviously every so often ING will make press releases about the workforce being cut. Is your footprint much smaller than when you began? Are you doing more with less?
Yes. I think I'm doing much more with less. Yes, I think that to give you a bit of an understanding, you know, if you look at the bank, you can basically structure the bank in different architectural building blocks. One is the channels. Number two is about customers, agreements, the marketing, really the customer heart. Then you have the product heart, where all the transactions and the current accounts and everything is in there. And finally, you have the support with HR and risk and finance and the entire IT for that layer. And I think that if you look today at IG, we are redoing it on everywhere. So we are doing core bank transformations, mobile development, omnichannel. So over the summer we took the shift from Angular to Polymer, because I think that we are convinced that Polymer better suits our needs in terms of becoming omnichannel. And you see the speed by which these things happen, it's just incomparable to 10 years ago when we had when people were working in Word to explain what we were going to do instead of doing it. Yes. I think with machine learning, you know, I will go myself, because sometimes I just like to learn. Eh? So I'll go to Berlin, I think, in 2 weeks to go to Flink. I think that many of my guys are very amazed with what Flink is offering these days. I don't know if, has anyone heard of Flink? Yes. You like it? Or? Yeah, so basically you see that there's a lot of machine learning in that direction as well. And for sure, the more I would almost say the already more mature kind of legacy frameworks like Hadoop. So there's a lot of investment in there.
Okay, you have a question?
Hi, Peter. You are saying that with ING you want to have your private cloud, right?
Yes.
So could you say what's your vision of that? Because I know there are many reasons to go to public clouds and many reasons not to. So what's your vision on that?
Yeah, I think the vision is that in the end, I think that we will eventually also go to public cloud or not. But let me first start why we don't do public cloud these days. It's a very simple one. We hate the Patriot Act. And the Patriot Act, you know, I don't know if you know this, this is US law. And therefore, ING on a group level has decided that for all your customer data and your transaction data, you don't go to a public cloud offering. But we do see shifts. Eh? We do see that Microsoft had won this appeal. And I think that also the US government will increasingly start to understand that this is limiting their own industry. So over time, this will most likely change. But that has been fundamental to us not taking the decision to go to the public cloud. If you then look at the public cloud, I think that they are amazing. I think Azure, Amazon, Google Cloud, I think that they are amazing with amazing propositions. I do think that, you get a lot, but there is still a lot of value in this full stack engineering, and the entire concept of immutable server patterns is at least stuff that we would like to see. I think it would, I would like to see how that would be adopted by those cloud providers. Fundamentally, I think that in the longer term it can. So you can basically have an assembly pipeline concept with fully immutable Docker containers and then publish them to an immutable host in Amazon, why not? So I'm not that against. I think that for now we're not doing it. And at least it means that we have to push extremely hard to have all our infrastructure guys understand that they are actually software engineers and that we work together in at least making it a bit of a non-issue. And then what I do like is once I had a presentation on the private cloud, and it was a fantastic presentation, it was called Why Private Clouds Always Fail. I saw the title, I was in a kind of a conference, a Gartner conference, I said, I need to go to that one. And there was a guy, and his also answer was, yeah, I put this title here, otherwise you wouldn't have shown up. So that's at least. But secondly, he said, I have three reasons why private clouds always fail. He said, number one, and I think fundamentally that's true, even in ING, you ask yourself the question, why are we building this private cloud? And then people have so many good reasons why they do it. It's for cost efficiency, it's for quality, it's for world peace, you know, it will stop hunger in Africa. there are 900 KPIs that we're going to track, and people don't dare to state, for us it's all about the speed of provision, or it's about the quality of the stack, or it's about, I don't know what you have, but take one or two, basically, and really focus on them and don't go for all the 900 benefits that you would get from it. I think the second comment they made is, with new tools, you don't fix broken processes. I hope that at least giving you some insights that if you have broken processes, especially around the imposition of an outcome, that you're going to misuse your new technology. And the third one, they said, infrastructure build a fantastic capability and there is no consumer using it. So basically, it is challenging to set up a private cloud, and at least you have to be aware of these three things.
I think you answered the first part of my question about why doesn't ING move to the ING private cloud, and especially why the security model is not accepted by infrastructure guys. I thought they were working together. And the second thing is, why don't you move to a European-only cloud?
Yeah, I think that they are all good comments, and the question is fundamentally we should and we will, and it's a bit of a question of the maturity. I think that some of you might have heard that we've built out our private cloud, and that's now come alive, but it came alive 3 months ago. So you could say, but Peter, where's your ambition? You have migrated your entire state to it, or you could say, at least take a bit of time to get there. And so we will get there. And a central cloud for the entire European bank is exactly what we need, because it's not for cost efficiency, but it allows collaboration between engineers. That's the most important thing you get. If you work together with a German guy and you don't share the same infrastructure, you need a USB stick to basically share code, you know, it doesn't work.
Unfortunately, that's all we have time for. I know there are a lot more questions. We're going into a break now, so you can ask them then. Let's get a huge round of applause for Peter.